For some time, I've been contemplating the peculiar situation that existed in Egypt at the beginning of the Christian era. The city of Alexandria had become the great center of learning for the entire Western civilization. Alexandria had been founded in the time of Alexander the Great, and was under the domination of the Greek pharaohs, the Ptolemies. And this domination continued until the death of Cleopatra, and then Rome took over. But the tremendous interest in Alexandria developed around the almost incomparable amassment of knowledge that was assembled there. Practically every field of human research was developed, unfolded, and progressed within the Alexandrian atmosphere. Alexandria was a city on the caravan routes. East and West mingled there. The Oriental doctrines and the Greco-Latin doctrines mingled together in a very strange confusion. After the rise of Christianity, both the Christian faith and Judaism had strong holdings in Alexandria, and it is safe to say that the composite there was made up of at least a dozen or 20 of the great religions and philosophies of antiquity. It was an amazing and unique center of learning. There was one other important factor in the Alexandrian complex, and that was the great structure of libraries. The Alexandrian libraries were the most famous in antiquity and probably the largest ever assembled in ancient times. The Serapeum and the Brachium contained together over 1 million manuscripts, tablets, and papyri containing the wisdom of the ancient world. When these libraries were ruthlessly destroyed, humanity was deprived of perhaps more knowledge than we will ever realize or appreciate. The destruction of these libraries also closed off our knowledge of the source of Alexandrian wisdom. It is quite possible that many ideas, beliefs, and doctrines, which we now believe were invented in Alexandria, were actually derived from the great research libraries, and therefore had a solid substance, but the substance has vanished, and only legends and fables remain. It is interesting, for example, to realize that the first and major interpreter of the fables of Aesop lived in Alexandria. Also, we learn that from Hero, one of the custodians of knowledge in that time, that Alexandrians invented the first slot machine. They did not spread out candies, bars, or cigarettes. Believe it or not, by putting a coin in a small slot, you received a sprinkle of holy water. But our modern slot machine is based upon the Alexandrian model. Everywhere we find them, in herbalism, in medicine, in philosophy, in art, literature, poetry, these mysterious people that occupied this great Egyptian area were almost universally learned. We know, for example, that the entire structure of Hermetic thinking and the story of Hermes Trismegistus arose in Alexandria. And we also know that the Alexandrians must have had a considerable sense of prophecy. It was there also that the Sibylline books developed that prophesied the future of the world. It was Ptolemy of Alexandria that gave the world astronomy and very largely contributed to the rise of astrology. There were zoological gardens. There were ponds for fish. There were reserves to protect animals. There was just about anything and everything you can think of. And not far outside of the boundaries of Alexandria stood the great group of pyramids, which have remained to this time the wonders of the world. Very little is actually known about the pyramids. Contemporary records are very scanty. They are mentioned by Herodotus in the 5th century B.C. But for the most part, no one has had an interest deep enough to attempt to investigate the circumstances surrounding the building of these great monuments. To this day, we really do not know why they were built, when they were built, and how it has happened that they have continued to intrigue human thinking for so long a period of time. Perhaps the most simple beginning for the search for pyramids is to realize that the pyramid builders represent a period in the development of human society. Pyramids were built in many different places. Probably one of the most interesting groups right here on the Western Hemisphere, the pyramid towers and temples of the Aztec and Maya culture. A few years ago, enormous pyramids were discovered in central China. And we know that the ziggurats of Babylon and Chaldea were all part of this great pyramid building scheme of things. The shape of the pyramid changed considerably in the course of time. In the beginning, it was a mound, and the very earliest examples still had the mound form, and these are still found in the great monuments in Java, the Borobudur, which is probably one of the most powerful and fascinating religious monuments now surviving, the Shwe Dagon in Rangoon, the great cities of the Khmer culture of Indochina, Cambodia, and Laos. All of these have pyramid structures peculiar to them. Pyramids appear, foreshortened or otherwise, also in graphic art. And among the mandalas of Tibet, Mongolia, Bhutan, Korea, China, and Japan, the pyramid design occurs frequently and represents a basis of a great meditation picture. This has led some scholars to assume that the pyramids were meditation symbols, that they were created for the purpose of reminding the individual that there was a mysterious reality underlying all the temporal and changeable patterns of mankind. In the Asclepian dialogue, Hermes describes the fact that in a sense these buildings were memorials to the divine power. They bore witness to those times and those thoughts when the gods walked with men. They became part of a traditional heritage. And if we study Neoplatonism, we will come to the conclusion that the gods who walked with men were actually the gods in men, that it was a divine level of insight which resulted in the great architectural feedback which we know as the pyramids. Actually, the circumstances around them challenge our imagination. We know that whoever built the Great Pyramid of Giza was well acquainted with astronomy, that he had a very complete knowledge of the solar system and all of the wonders of the cosmic plan as revealed through the bodies and objects moving in the heavens. He knew the distances between the Earth and the other planets of the solar system. He knew the precession of the equinoxes. He realized the importance of the star groups. He already knew the decans and dodecanates of the of the zodiac. These things just do not fit into the general concept that we have of the state of the world when the pyramid was presumed to have been built. The only possible answer is, on this level, that at the time the pyramid builders labored, they had a knowledge among themselves that had not been distributed to the people. Even the rulers did not possess this knowledge. And that there was a cult or sect of architects and artificers, the builders of monuments, who knew the proportions and mathematics and had deeply imbibed from the wisdom of Pythagoras and Euclid. But even this isn't a complete explanation, for it is almost impossible to determine how this tremendous job was done. The idea that we have is far too trite. The thought that perhaps they were simply built as a result of slave labor in Egypt will not hold water. It is simply not sufficient. The amount of work that is involved in those monuments simply transcends imagination. Also, they require a skill and a group of instrumental aids, which we do not believe that antiquity possessed. So a great many persons long ago in Alexandria, and more recently right here now, have fallen back upon this supernatural hypothesis. When we can't imagine how a thing was done, we begin to believe that it must have been done by magic or some supernatural power or force. The Chinese have long believed that their Great Wall was built by the gods. They did not believe that any human being could build it. And it is only natural when we come into the presence of something that transcends our own abilities that we begin to wonder whether some strange esoteric means was involved, as in the case of the statues on Easter Island and many other such unsolved mysteries of antiquity. To fall back upon this supernatural theory is comforting to a degree, but it can lead us into serious complications. Because we know that the Egyptians and other nations of that period were esotericists. We know that they had a knowledge of natural law far ahead of their time, and they had a responsibility for the use of natural law far ahead of our time. These people had a deep appreciation for the immensity and integrity of the universal plan. They had already discovered thousands of years ago that you cannot break natural law without suffering. They had never developed that strange type of egotism which impels us often to assume that God is depending upon us to take care of his purposes and plans. They did not think this. They realized or believed that they were the servants of an infinite reality. Now, in the development of Neo-Alexandrian mysticism, we have an interesting point that is brought out by Plotinus and Proclus, namely that mysticism, which is an internalization of faculties and which releases certain esoteric forces within the person, very often, in fact, almost always, also gives rise to a less fortunate situation, and that is psychic phenomena. The mystic is more inclined than anyone else to believe in the psychic factors of life. And because these are inconstant, and because most of them arise within the imagination of individuals, psychism leads to difficulties, even while mysticism leads to spiritual attainment. They are not the same thing. The pyramid, as it stands today, is, of course, the largest and most important of several groups of such similar buildings scattered around through Egypt and other parts of North Africa. For all intent and purposes, we are told that at the year 820 A.D., the Caliph al-Ma'mun al-Baghdad brought a large number of workmen to Egypt to explore the Great Pyramid. The reason he did this was because there was a legend to the effect that the pyramid had been built by mysterious giants called the Shedai, that they had buried within the pyramid a great treasure and had guarded it with demons and monsters and all kinds of supernatural forces. Al-Ma'mun wanted to study this for himself, and he also was very anxious to get hold of that treasure, which was presumably somewhere within the pyramid. In order to gain his end, this son of the faithful brought with him workmen from Baghdad. These workmen were good Muslims and were also honest and faithful servants of the caliph. But likewise, they had been induced to hope that were the treasure found, they would benefit also. In fact, they had been assured that such would be the case. And one day, in the early 9th century, the caliph Al-Ma'mun stood at the face and base of the Great Pyramid. It was one shining surface. All of the capping stones were in place. There was no mark or opening anywhere on any of the four sides. It was so perfectly covered that it reflected the sun like a mirror. On all of the sides of the southeast and west, glistened and gleamed with the light of the sun, and only the north side was silent and dark. Ma'mun was completely overwhelmed by this structure, over 400 feet in height. A shining pyramid-shaped body rising from a square base with four equilateral triangular sides. He just stood and looked at it. But the important thing for us, I think, to remember is that at that time, all of the surfacing stones were in place. The pyramid did not consist of a series of steps of blocks. Everything was smooth. Each level had been cased and surfaced with properly cut stones, so perfectly trued that it was not possible to insert a knife blade in the space between them. It is also believed that much of this work was done without any cement because the fittings of the stones were so perfect. Sometime between about the 9th century and now, all these casing stones have disappeared except six. There are six stones left that to remind us of what was originally the entire facing of the building. These stones are huge, weigh hundreds, maybe thousands of pounds, and they are still in place, but that's all there is of them. All the rest have gone. Now, we are told that they probably were used to build various structures in the city of Cairo, that they were used to create palaces and mosques for the Muslims, and that little by little, the Great Pyramid was turned into a quarry to be the source of base materials for building purposes. This answers one question, however, that we have to consider. There are some marks on the sides of the pyramid, considerable distance from the ground, which have been believed to mark water erosion, and the idea that the pyramid was at some time or other submerged up at least two-thirds of the way. If Ma'mun's statements can be believed, this is not possible. Also, it is more likely that these marks that look like water erosions are actually sand erosions that were the result of sand blowing against the walls after the capping stones and facing stones had been removed. So the probabilities of the so-called antediluvian date remains speculative. We do not know. One thing is probably inevitable, that whoever built the pyramid had a very great knowledge and presumably was wiser than most of the peoples in the world today. We know, when I was in Egypt, I talked to a French architect who was standing alongside me at the foot of the Great Pyramid. And he said, if this building had not survived, if the modern world had had nothing in the form of knowledge except reports about it, and the building had not been, had not continued to exist, there isn't a soul on earth who would believe that it had ever been built. And this is more or less the situation. The only reason we have to accept it is because it's there. And the more we study it, the less we know about it. Now, the modern researchers have found in the pressure spaces above the King's Chamber some markings which are assumed to be part of the inscription of the pharaoh Cheops, that this cartouche of Cheops. But when you see the cartouche photographed, it's hard to get to look at the actual one. The condition is so dim and so faint that there may be very grave doubt as to whether Cheops had anything to do with it at all. In the first place, a proud pharaoh wishing to mark a building as a proof of his own skills would not have placed those inscriptions in a position where they could never be read, never could be seen, and in the process of completing the building were most of them mutilated or completely obliterated. Therefore, it is not at all likely that the proud pharaoh put something in those chambers that could not be found for thousands of years, and then only by accident. Most of the Egyptian monuments are clearly marked with the cartouches of their originators. Some of them also have taken off an earlier cartouche and put their own in its place, the cartouche being an oval lozenger containing the name of the pharaoh. So the Cheops theory is pretty weak, although it is still clung to for lack of a better one. And I think the real thing we have to go into in studying this is to find out, if we can, what the actual meaning of the building is, why it was put where it is, why other buildings and the Sphinx are in the same and particular relationship to each other. Some of the more thoughtful progressives have come to the possible conclusion that the Great Pyramid was part of a great calendar system, that by means of it, it was possible to calculate most of the important phenomena of astronomy. The ancients did not have telescopes as we know them, but they did have ways of calculating mathematically the various positions of planets and the precession of the equinoxes. And it's been suggested that the Great Pyramid and its immediate surrounding structures was a tremendous calendar structure, perhaps the oldest known to man. This is not unreasonable if we think about it. We know that one of the pyramids in Yucatan, in Chichen Itza, was an observatory, the parts of which still remain and record know. We know that it was an observatory. There are also other indications. The great ziggurats of Babylonia and Chaldea were towers for stargazing. They were where the ancient Chaldeans studied the heavens year after year, century after century. And according to Budge of the British Museum, many of these studies and calculations were carried on for 10 or 20,000 years. One thing that comes to mind then in connection with this whole situation is that we may have to revise our understanding of what antiquity was like. Perhaps we cannot assume that we have gradually arisen from a completely barbarian state and that in a few thousand years behind our present culture there was nothing but a colossal ignorance. This concept will not hold. Somewhere along the way there were tremendous minds, a great body of knowledge that was capable of planning and executing unbelievable works of skill, beauty, and wisdom. The Egyptians themselves were of the opinion that at a remote time the gods had been with men, that deities and divine powers walked the earth. Now, this again may be regarded as symbolical. Perhaps what they were trying to tell us is that in a remote time long ago, the human being was naturally mystical, naturally had the power of extrasensory perception, naturally could communicate or understand, estimate, or react to the divine principles upon which the universe was based. That the gods walking with men merely meant that the God power in man was not obscured as it is now. That gradually over a course of time, the material world has taken over. The ancient peoples had a very simple physical existence comparatively. There was no problem of population, no intensive competition in trade, and wars were comparatively limited to a few swashbuckling militarists. The people in general lived a very quiet and a natural life, completely dependent upon their insights into universal laws. Just as the American Indian, without any assistance from the outside, not only developed a profound mysticism, but evolved from within himself practically every law, rule, and principle necessary to the government of his affairs. The Great League of the Iroquois was probably one of the most important movements of international peace that the world ever knew. And yet it was developed and perfected by Indians sitting under trees, wrapped in skins of animals and with feathers in their hair. And yet these people, intuitively and internally, had a tremendous depth of insight. This depth of insight has been lost as the result of the individual being subjected to continual external conditioning. He is taught from childhood not to think for himself, not to search within himself for the answers to his problems, but to read them out of books and have them conferred upon him by physical educational processes. As a result of that, he has lost the power of direct contact with realities. His new philosophy, if you could call it such, is built entirely upon the opinions of his contemporaries and the interpretations by these contemporaries of earlier documents and beliefs. If we assume that the individual was a source of almost complete knowledge, that he had the skills and the abilities to intuit nearly everything necessary to his own survival, it is then quite probable that we are gradually going to learn that the leaders of this intuitive procedure were parts of a great sacerdotal group. You might be willing to call them the mysterious sages, the wise men of ancient times, the first ones of the earth who knew, and the giants of mind and thought who were upon the earth in those days. In any event, however, there was undoubtedly a tradition that descended into Egypt from a still earlier source, a tradition based upon an internal development of spiritual resources, a development which went back perhaps to India or to one of the ancient civilizations that have now vanished away. But by 4,000 or 5,000 or even 10,000 B.C., there was a great knowledge in the hands or in the keeping of a few persons. And these few persons more or less set up the system of mysteries which operated in Egypt, Greece, and the Roman Empire. Now, in this also, I think it is very important to bear in mind that the initiate system, which was the prevailing system in Egypt at that time, was based upon one tremendous point, a point which we have lost, a point which we have never really attempted to restore, but about which we have given considerable thought and consideration. The purposes of the mysteries, according to such initiates as Plotinus, Proclus, Iamblichus, Ammonius, Saccas, and others, was very simple. that the individual should learn factually, truly, beyond question, beyond doubt, through personal experience, that death is an illusion. That immortality is the summit of man's problem. That the ancients not only believed in it, but kept this belief in secret, but developed a science by means of which they could communicate the fact and example and circumstance of death directly to another person. In other words, the initiates of the mysteries, according to the old concepts, were persons who had lived, died, and been born again in this world. In order to accomplish this, there was an elaborate ritual system, because upon the concept of immortality was built the entire problem of an enduring material culture in this world. If immortality was demonstrable, beyond question, not the result of communication, not because certain famous person had believed it, not because we wanted to believe it, or because it was written in sacred books or anything of that nature, but because the individual who believed it had died, passed through the experience, and come back to life. This was the burden of the mystery system, was to prove conclusively that death was not the end of anything. Cicero marks this in his discussion of his relationships with life. Marcus Aurelius refers to it. But he refers to it, as they all did, as something known, not something believed. Something that could not be denied because it had been an actual experience in the life of the believer. Thus, in the mystery system, in the Egyptian, which we are interested in the moment particularly, the Book of the Dead, which is a misnomer, part of the same type of misnomer that afflicts us in many other ways. The Book of the Dead, so-called, the Egyptian name for which was not the Book of the Dead, but the Book of the Coming Forth by Day and of the Opening of the Mouth. This was the famous name in ancient times for such great papyri as are in the Museum of the British Museum, of the Papyrus of Ani and the Papyrus of Henufa. These were great examples of the dead coming back to life through the mysteries. Therefore, the ancient philosophy of life was built upon an eternality of life. It was built upon the fact that the individual was for everlastingness, that he would go on. There was no end to him. There was no one converting people to this. There was no one preaching it or teaching it. In the mysteries, the candidate went through it himself as an actual fact. And as Apuleius tells us in the Metamorphoses, the initiate in the temple tread upon the threshold of Persephone, that is the underworld, and beheld the spirits. He went into the realm of death and returned again. Eugene O'Neill's play, Lazarus Laughed, is built upon this theme and is derived very largely from the ancient teachings. In the play, Lazarus, as had been raised from the dead by Christ, lived on for a time and was finally persecuted in Rome by the Emperor Caligula. And finally, Caligula threatened Lazarus with death. And Lazarus laughed at him. The man who had died laughed at the man who thought he could kill anything. And this was the burden of the mystery. That the individual who knew, not because he could believe or have faith, but because through the rite ceremonies and esoteric practices of the temple, he lived through it and came through alive. And came out of darkness into light, knew as a certainty beyond question that there was no death. Now, we don't realize, perhaps, how important this point would be in the modeling of civilization. We do not realize how oppressive the concept of death is, and how the punishments of the dead in the theological systems, how they may torture or terrify the person. The main point was to establish the reality of survival and its associate belief, the consciousness or concept of rebirth. Rebirth was simply immortality, spaced out. It was a part of the everlasting, ever-livingness of everything that exists. The ancients, therefore, had very little fear of death, and something of the form of a mystical experience of this probably influenced the Christian martyrs in the Circus Maximus in Rome when they died for their faith. There was something about it all that transformed a life of fear into a life of certainty. It also removed the dynamic importance of material existence and represented it in this world as merely the antechamber to eternity itself. Now, Hermes and several of the others and people of the Alexandrian period like to consider the Great Pyramid as the tomb of Hermes. It is so referred to by the Neoplatonic Alexandrian mystics, who had quite a good insight into this particular problem. It was not a tomb for a dead pharaoh. It was a symbol of the gateway to the other world and the way to return to it again. This initiation rite was undoubtedly sustained by the use of esoteric skills and powers that we know very little about at the present time. But it was believed that it was the tomb of wisdom, the house of the hidden places, the mysterious structure, which in a sense was a monument to eternity, standing upon the earth, pointing upward with a continuing point, so that everything below verged toward the top, and it was like a finger reaching up into immortality. The word pyramid itself is derived from pier, meaning fire. Therefore, the building was flame-shaped, and in the times when the stones were all in place, it glistened like a glowing flame with its mysterious point upward. Also, it was a marker. In the Bible, it is probably the monument that was set up in Egypt, according to the Old Testament. In any event, the Neoplatonists and those of that period thought of it, likened it to a house of the second birth, the house where the individual who was born first into this world learned the mystery of it. And I believe it was Porphyry, may have been Plotinus, who said on one occasion that in human life, birth physically was the human being coming out of the womb into a body, and that this body itself became the womb of the second birth. For the individual retaining enlightenment transcended the limitation of body, and those who did not achieve this were born out of body into an unembodied state at the end of life. So that this pattern was regarded as part of the mystery ritual. Another interesting example of this particular type of thought is to be found in Judo in Japan. Judo and many other of the self-defensive arts of the Orient are concerned with a peculiar kind of courage, a courage which must be completely free from anxiety and fear. If the fear exists. The individual is weakened by the rise of a terror within himself, and therefore usually comes to disaster in his own day and in his own way. So in judo, before the artist achieves the highest grades of the art, he must be killed. His teacher kills him. His teacher performs certain structural pressures upon the body that stop the heart. And the heart is allowed to be stopped for a certain number of seconds, or early 1 or 2 minutes. Then the master resuscitates the disciple by pressure upon other parts of the body, according to the higher grades of judo. And in this case, the person who has been killed lives again, remembers and knows what happened to him, and realizes that his fear of death was ungrounded, that the fear of transition, which might make him a coward in this world, was simply an illusion of his own mind, that actually transition was just as normal, natural, and reasonable as any other aspect of life, and that there was no interruption. The individual never ceased to be an immortal being, whether in body or out of it. Now, the Egyptians apparently built on this very, very strongly. So did the Hindus. They felt or realized the tremendous significance of this realization that there was no termination, that there was no end, that the labors of a life were never lost, and that the achievements of a life were forever necessary, that the individual who had an idea that his virtues might go to oblivion with him was wrong. And the one who believed that his vices would go to oblivion with him, he also is wrong. There is an interruption of place, but not of state. There is an interruption in the sequence of relationships between the individual and the material body, but no interruption in the continuity of the life within that body. Thus, materialism, which has become more or less prevalent in our time,